check it, buddy. The Weasel.
What's up?
Check it. Crusty dude chilling on your melon body.
Hey, buddy, let me check out your stony.
Chilling, man.
Hey, wait, one sec, buddy.
Hey, you know what? Me and my sister, we watch your show every day, tape it, and we cut out the videos.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
Hey, man, sawing my leg. You got a pen?
Mm-mm.
Here. No. Saw my hand. Here. No, saw my arm. No, saw my head.
Your head. You're saying you want me to sign your melon, bro. Your melon. Lynn. Okay, cool. Check it. Totally. Oh, this is a trip, bro. I've never signed anyone's melon. Totally Pauly, bro. Boom, right there. Is that cool?
Hey, man, how'd you get on MTV?
Well, when I first started with MTV...
How'd you get on TV? Put me on MTV, man. Put me and my sister on MTV, okay. And I'll tape it. All right? Put me on MTV, Pauly. Hey, homie, put me on MTV, Pauly. Okay. Put me and my sister and my grandmother on MTV, and I'll tape it. Put me on MTV, Pauly.
I feel like a duck-billed platypus.
Ow!
Dude, check out the knots.
It's the Leaning Tower of Cheesa.
Let's go, Tybalt! Great adventures await!
Welcome back to Dystopian Dance Party's Year of the Weasel. I'm Zach.
I'm Kelly.
And we're picking up. I know we need to be more. You know what we need to do? We need to start doing.
Back. Have you heard this totally different Pauly? Where one of the like voiceovers in the intro is like, I'm back.
And every time we say Year of the Weasel, we need to do.
Yeah.
You know,
can you do that?
I tried. Cool. I just tried.
I don't know how he does it so quick.
I don't know.
It's what I gotta practice for next.
Yeah, people say he's not talented, but like I can't fucking do the weasel noise.
Yeah, it's like he does it so loud too.
So we're picking up this week where we left off last episode, which was before any of Pauly's movies. We're taking two full episodes to get to the first movie, but I feel like we're justifying it because, you know, once you watch this other stuff, you realize that they literally just like control C the weasel and then control V'd into Encino Man. So I feel like this is necessary background knowledge. So today we're going to talk about Pauly's big break on MTV in the early 90s. This is an era that I like to call peak weasel. But before we get into it, I wanted to acknowledge some exciting developments in the Pauly-verse between... So we recorded our last episode back in January. We were going to try and get it out on February 1st, which is Pauly's birthday. And I got the flu and then I got sidetracked for like 3 weeks. I have the flu excuse. I don't know what else. I don't know why the rest of it happened, but I guess we missed the deadline. So I was like, whatever. I'll get to it when I get to it. But it was kind of an inopportune time. Because a lot of stuff has happened. I mean, you know, by our standards.
Yeah, have you heard of all what's happening with Pauly Shore in 2024? What? You haven't heard about it?
I know. It's like the top news story for us. But so first, in late January, this was like literally right after we recorded, there was a premiere of a short film called The Court Jester. That's the short film where Pauly portrays Richard Simmons of Sweatin' to the Oldies fame. Those of you watching this, you may have even seen this because it kind of got some social media traction. Like, I think Kia showed me something from Instagram about it. And of course we follow Pauly. So he was talking about it a lot.
He was definitely marketing that.
He was in Park City during Sundance for the premiere. You'll notice I said during Sundance and not at Sundance, because the movie was not an official Sundance selection, which I had to kind of read the fine print to know. If I just followed Pauly Shore's account, I would have believed that it was at Sundance Film Festival, but it was at Park City. And I mean, this is a thing. It's like, this is a legitimate thing that people do. It's, you know, everybody, the idea is that there's all these industry people who are going to be in Park City for that weekend, so that even if you're not an official selection, you still screen it adjacent to the festival to get eyes on it. So this, you know, got some buzz because it's a very, you know, what a headline, right? Like, Pauly Shore plays Richard Simmons,
which is apparently something that fans have been demanding for a while.
The long-awaited Richard Simmons film.
This might come up later too, because I did recently watch an episode of Totally Different Pauly where it was kind of like foreshadowing for this movie.
Yeah, I watched that one too, and I was like, you know, like the Leonardo DiCaprio meme where he points at the TV. I was like, oh my god, what other events did Totally Pauly predict? I don't have that much else to say about The Court Jester. I will say the film was officially disavowed by Richard Simmons. You know, he like never makes public statements, but he broke his media silence to say that he never gave his permission for the movie.
Which, by the way, that sucks. I don't really like the way that Richard Simmons is treated by the media, to be clear. Like, yeah. I don't. If you didn't want this movie to be made, it's not fair that it got made. But at the same time, I'm glad it got made.
Right.
Having not seen it.
And I think also if he, like, it is on YouTube, so I've actually watched it. And I think if Richard Simmons saw the movie, there's not much there to be offended by. You know, I think on paper, the idea, Pauly Shore is playing Richard Simmons, you expect it to be like a really broad caricature. I mean, he's literally just like, I'm not going to say it's a great performance. He's just being Pauly Shore, but in like, you know, 80s athletic wear. Like, it's not, you know, the fact that they both have big curly hair is doing 100% of the heavy lifting.
I know. Well, okay, I'll just talk about it now. So the episode I was alluding to was an episode, I think it was on Totally Different Pauly. He is visiting like some LA gymnastics thing, like gym or something. Basically, he puts on like 80s, early 90s athletic wear, and they keep putting like Richard Simmons like over the screen, like in text. And he keeps like telling the cameraman to stop calling him Richard Simmons.
Take the Richard Simmons off. Now, take it off. Right.
Hey, you know what?
So this is a role literally decades in the making. So yeah, I would be curious. I mean, I don't think we're going to hear anything else from Richard Simmons. He's famously, you know, retired from public life. I think he probably said his piece on this movie, but I do think that if he saw it, you know, there's not much there to be offended by. It's not like they're making fun of Richard Simmons. It's actually kind of a cute, heartwarming movie.
Also, in recent polling news, he got sued for alleged battery and assault at the Comedy Store.
Yes, I was actually, that is in my notes. I was gonna say that.
The reason I found out about it was because we were still, it was, I looked back at our text thread to find the article that I sent. It was on February 1st because we were still talking about like if we would be able to release it or not.
Right.
And I was like, is Pauly Shore's birthday the first or the second? I couldn't remember. And you're like, the first. And so I just sent that article because I looked it up to verify. And that was the first thing that came up, was this article about him getting sued. I guess it was like a situation that happened a year prior to this, but the the article is from January 28th, 2024.
Right.
And so I sent it to you and I was like, well, oh yeah, it is on the first. Well, happy birthday. Yeah. Yeah.
According to the USA Today article here, the Comedy Store's security personnel allegedly violently grabbed and attacked the plaintiffs, a guy named Sean Kehoe and his daughter, Kira Lynn Potts. According to the lawsuit, Shore knew that the group planned to assault Kehoe and agreed with and encouraged them. Not funny. The way it's written is funny. To assault Kehoe. Yeah. And Shore intended that the assault be committed.
It's horrible that it happened. But I also just wonder, and I'm not making excuses for Pauly, but I also was just thinking that, like, he's been violently thrown out of clubs and thrown into a dumpster so many times that maybe he just thinks that's a perfectly, like, this normal just way to kick someone out of your club.
This is just normal for him. We've all seen the Lisa Lisa video, you know?
Yeah. I also love we all seen the Lisa Lisa video. You know?
We've all seen it. I'm getting a little my perspective is very skewed because I've been consuming so much Pauly Shore content that
everyone's seen this, right?
So that catches us up. That's the latest Pauly Shore news. I also just want to quickly say we've gotten some comments. I feel like at some point we might have to do like a mailbag episode.
It's also like our mailbag is never worth doing unless people are pissed off at us.
I know.
No one has been pissed off at us about anything except for Kiss.
Yeah,
so
where are the Pauly Shore? Where's the Weez Army? Like, why are they not offended? Maybe as our takes get spicier, people will get, because so far we've been pretty complimentary. Which is actually part of the point of this comment from our buddy Marty White. He said, this will be interesting. I was expecting you to have as much respect for Pauly as you do for Mike. I despise Pauly, but I'm hoping to have my mind changed. Yeah, it does occur to me that our whole brand is being really irreverent. And the one exception so far has been the universally derided Pauly Shore. But I think that's partly, you know, I think that that's, I do like to.
And we just talked about how he was sued for stalking.
Well, I do like to root for the underdog. And I think a lot of the reason why we.
Pauly Shore the underdog.
I mean, he kind of is now. Yeah.
Yeah, like
I think context.
He acts as though he's the underdog. Yeah, his persona is the underdog. So.
Right. And I mean, I think his critical reputation took such a nosedive in the 90s and hasn't really recovered since then. So, you know, I feel like a lot of the reason for my animus toward Mike Myers is because when we talked about this, and those of you who haven't, the many of you who haven't listened to 12 Months of Mike, I was just thinking about that. I always kind of downplay 12 Months of Mike because the movies sucked, but the episodes were actually pretty good.
All of the episodes were good, with the exception of Shrek 3.
It was probably 3 and 4 probably weren't great, but Shrek 3 was the one where we tried to do it live watching a YouTube feed
while
we were recording. So I don't recommend that one, but I stand by pretty much all of the other episodes. They were pretty funny. But yeah, I think so. We talked about this at the time, but a lot of the reason why I have so much hostility toward Mike Myers is the entire decade of the 1990s. He was being touted as this, you know, like an heir apparent to Peter Sellers, you know, like he's this fucking comedic genius. And meanwhile, he's making movies where he drinks a fat Scottish man's shit and thinks it's coffee, you know? And so it's like, what the hell, like what is happening? And so there's something I respect about Pauly Shore where it's like, he knows what he is, you know. Nobody's
would you rather
him.
Watch if you're going joke for joke, would you rather watch a movie where they drink a fat Scottish man shit as if it were coffee, or would you rather watch Stephen Baldwin farting and Pauly Shore trying to discern what he ate that day? Like, joke for joke, which one do you prefer?
Yeah, I don't know. This is just a pathology of mine where, like, if something is really praised, I'm more prejudiced against it. If people hate something, I'm more likely to try and find.
Here's a question though, because Kiss are also obnoxious Jewish men who consider themselves to be the underdog, but in many ways are not.
Right.
Why do we hate Kiss with that same criteria?
Yeah, that's a good question.
But the thing is, we do like Kiss. There's just a healthy dose of irony, and people assume we hated Kiss. So I guess that's what it is.
Right.
I talked myself through that. Sorry.
See, it's perfectly consistent.
Don't answer. I know the shit.
All right. So we'll get back to our main topic of discussion. I don't know how long this is. I mean, how long this episode is going to be depends entirely on how much we can just riff on episodes of Totally Pauly, because that's 90% of what we've got to talk about today. But let's talk about how Totally Pauly happened. When we last left off, it's 1989. Pauly's comedy is gaining in popularity, specifically his character, the Weasel. And so through that, he makes his first, and probably also through the fact that his mom owns the comedy store, and he probably had very good representation. He made his first appearance on MTV's annual Spring Break special in Daytona Beach. So this is from the Spin article behind the Weezick. Pauly said, "I had to pay my own way, but I didn't even care. I was just thinking, I'm going to get laid. I'm going to be cool. I'm going to be on MTV. So I went down there and no one knew who the fuck I was. It was just like being back in junior high, trying to be accepted by the Beverly Hills kids." He continues, "They put me on the air for like half a second during the top 20 countdown. Buster Poindexter's on one side and Downtown Julie Brown's on the other side. I felt the need to quote this at length just because Buster Poindexter is also here, and that automatically makes any situation like 100 times more surreal that Buster Poindexter and Pauly Shore were both present." He said, "They're in lounge chairs and I'm kneeling in between them. My knees are pressing into pebbles and shit, and I'm really uncomfortable. There's thousands of spring breakers. The pressure was huge. And Buster, who was drunk, asked me a simple question. 'Pauly, you're from California,' he says. 'What's the difference between the beaches in Florida and the beaches in California?' And I look around like it's a fucking trick question. And then I look at the camera and go, 'Everyone's wasted.' And there's just dead silence." Afterward, Downtown Julie Brown started cursing me out for giving such a stupid answer. I could not find that footage. I tried my hardest. I really want to see it.
I like anything, any awkward situation that Buster Poindexter is involved in. Like, I love one of my favorite. Yeah, there are so many of them that exist. One of my favorite ones is when he was announcing some award show winner with Little Richard. Well, what the Grammys? Okay,
it was best new
Little
artist.
Richard keeps like he says,
"And the best new artist is me."
I think about that all the time. Yeah, I know. That's just one of those, like in my mental soundboard. It's Little Richard saying me.
And then he like keeps stalling and keeps saying silly stuff and keeps like saying it to him. And then finally, Buster Poindexter is like, "Richard." Yeah. One of my favorite clips.
And Buster just has to stand there and like smile.
I know. He keeps like, you know, people are awkward, so they keep like licking their lips and like putting their hands behind their back.
"And the winner is still me." "Good morning."
So imagine that, but with Pauly Shore channeling Jeff Spicoli instead. I did find footage from the Daytona Beach special, and I'll drop some in. There's like a thing where Pauly rides a mechanical surfboard. And I can confirm Buster Poindexter and Downtown Julie Brown were there. So the story's probably true. It just hasn't been preserved. Totally Pauly fan if you're out there.
Yeah. Can you find it?
Do you have the footage? there's also another part where they're like bouncing back and forth between hosts, and one of the hosts accidentally says Corey instead of Pauly. Because Corey Feldman was also there.
Let's get back to Julie Corey at the mechanical surfboard. Okay, that's right. Here we are.
No, it's Julie and Pauly, not Julie and Corey. Corey's history. Thank you very much.
Anyway. Oh, it was his podcast where he had Corey Feldman on there, and Corey Feldman said that he was supposed to play both Link and Stoney. Or no, it was and whoever Sam Gamgee's character is.
Yeah, but I mean, he was up for what he was considered separately for the roles. It's not that he was supposed to play a dual role.
No, but that would be amazing. In my mind, that's what I was saying, but it didn't come out that way. But also, I prefer that. Yeah. I really want there to be like a double impact type thing where it's Pauly Shore and Corey Feldman on the screen all at once.
Corey Feldman playing two roles that he doesn't have the range for either of them, and yet somehow he's playing both.
They just do the stupid thing where it's like there's just a slightly more like a transparent picture in different
Yes. So Corey Feldman, this is not the last time Corey Feldman shows up in the Pauly Shore, in the Pauly-verse.
In the Pauly-verse.
In the Pauly Cinematic Universe. Oh, it's more like he almost was in the Pauly Cinematic Universe. But, you know.
Well, he's in there. He's in there in some universe. He's in there, just not ours, unfortunately.
Exactly. There's probably a universe where he does play both roles.
Isn't that like the rule of the multiverse?
There's infinite universes.
Yeah. If I thought of it, then surely it exists. And I wish that we were in that universe.
So the spin article, you know, this his first time on MTV doesn't go great. But then he gets a televised set on the Fox TV show Comic Strip Live. This is another one. I couldn't find it. But his manager sent a tape to MTV. And they invited him back to be a guest VJ in early 1990. And this time, he was so popular that he ended up getting his own show. And this is Totally Pauly. So now we're finally here. We're finally at The Weasel Has Arrived. That premiered June 4th, 1990. According to the Spin article, the show doubled ratings for its time period. So MTV originally had a three-month contract, had Pauly on a three-month contract, and they extended it like right away. And Totally Pauly was on the air in some form or another for 5 years, which pretty much, if you were to place a timeline of Totally Pauly, 1990 to 95, and a timeline of Pauly Shore's time in the cultural zeitgeist, it's a exact match. 90 to 95, that's it. So let's talk about Totally Pauly a little bit. I feel like more research, there needs to be more work done on this. Like I already shouted out Totally Pauly fan. They're
steadily uploading stuff. There was new stuff there from like a couple days ago.
They're doing the Lord's work.
Generally when I'm interested in something and then I find it, it's like from years and years ago. But this is like a currently updating thing where every day I can go on YouTube and there will be a new Totally Pauly like, episode for me to
like
watch.
It's like it's new. It's like it's back on the air for us. Yeah. We're discovering it in real time. The problem with that, though, is that the list of people interested in the history of Totally Pauly, as far as I'm aware, there's three people. Maybe four if you count Pauly Shore. So I don't really understand, you know, a lot about the production history. I know that Totally Pauly, I know it's basically like a VJ vehicle, you know, certainly at least the early episodes. If you watch what Totally Pauly fan uploaded, it's little interstitial sketches and then he'll introduce a video, you know? And so that was at least the premise at the very beginning. It feels to me a little bit like it drifts away from that. And maybe that's why later seasons, I think starting in 92, it started being called Totally Different Pauly. And I've been like racking my brain trying to figure out what is totally different about Totally Different Pauly, because from where I'm sitting, it seems kind of fucking the same, but I think there are some subtle distinctions.
I think you're definitely onto something, because I remember when I was watching just the older Totally Pauly, it would be like he would announce, it's really funny too, like it's such a time capsule of what he's announcing, because it's like Take Me to the Other Side by Aerosmith plays all the time. There's like several Jane Child songs, which like I thought she was a one-hit wonder, but there's like other songs that she's done that I've not even, that I hadn't even heard of until, well, I mean, I could have heard of them, but I didn't until Pauly Shore announced them. And then like, cause I just always had heard Don't Want to Fall in Love, hadn't looked anything else into her catalog. And then Pauly Shore is announcing all these Jane Child songs that I'm like, this was a thing. But yeah, it's just kind of interesting how like you kind of get an idea of what the musical landscape was like in the early 90s, at least from MTV. Like obviously it's not the entire musical landscape, but like what was popular and what was playing on MTV a lot.
Yeah.
And
then,
the reason I started saying that is I think you're onto something, because in the later, the Totally Different Pauly, it seems to be more like, the way it makes me think, because I know in our last episode we were talking about how it kind of predates YouTube and TikTok and things like that. It's almost like a come scuba diving with me.
Yeah,
and
he goes
and takes scuba diving classes. Or it's like, I'm going to try this dating thing called Great Expectations. And then he's doing like basically an online dating, or like video dating or whatever.
Right.
So it's very much like or almost like travel YouTube too. I watch a lot of stuff of people doing things in Japan, because I'm going there soon, but it'll be like, I went to this onsen or whatever. And then in Totally Different Pauly, it's like he went to this gymnastics class and like all these different stuff. Like kind of
everybody was almost calling like, Richard Simmons.
Yeah, it could happen. Yeah, but even like the scuba diving class is like, oh yeah, tell us what the name of the scuba place is so that people can go. Like it's kind of almost advertising for that scuba class.
You know, again, if somebody wants to fact check me, I'm all for it. I want there to be more knowledge about Totally Pauly in the universe, but I don't notice him calling out videos as much, and it just feels to me more high concept, the Totally Different Pauly stuff. It's more like an actual, I mean, I think for one thing, the budget gets bigger, because like the early episodes are very rooted in his stand-up. Like there's a lot of, you can hear a lot of repeated jokes with the later stand-up specials. Like I mentioned last time, there's an episode in the first season where he takes his mom's credit card and he goes around and like he's taking these two leases around to different that's where in our trailer where he's like, check out the nugs, you know. That's what that episode is from, and he's like spending money on his mom's credit card, which feels very much like a premise. You know, his mom is, like I said last time, his mom is very much a character in his extended universe. So, yeah, I mean, like the early episodes. So I'm looking at a list of season one episodes. I mean, the first one is literally just him driving around in Hollywood telling stories about different, you know, it's like giving a Hollywood tour, basically, which feels very like, hey, we've got a camera and we've got Pauly Shore, a guy who grew up in Hollywood. Let's make a show out of this. And then, you know, there's some higher concept ones, like the second one. I love the second episode where he's like a businessman. Have you watched that one?
I don't think so. I haven't watched them in any kind of order. I literally just go where the YouTube algorithm and Totally Pauly fan want me to go. Right. So they've been completely out of order and I don't know the names of any of the episodes.
Anytime Pauly is like trying to play a straight adult is very, very funny to me. It's like when a black comedian does white voice, you know, but it's Pauly Shore. So it makes less sense because, you know, Pauly Shore is a wealthy white person. So he doesn't technically need to code switch. And yet he does. So
I'm going to check out the facts. OK, because you got to have facts in your life, people, in order to have procedures taken care of.
Fax is coming in. Money market man. Paula Abdul. Okay. Escrows. Escargos. They're in my backyard.
And then I think it might be, I don't know, there's one of these episodes, like, they dramatize one of his jokes from his stand-up, which is, like, he's complaining about his stepdad, and I mean, I've heard this joke so many different times. It's in, like, it's in his album, it's in the Pauly Does Dallas special.
Oh, it's God, totally it's like Pauly. When we were doing the David Lee Roth book, and I just heard the fucking brown M&M story so many times that yes. I started to have like a Pavlovian response to it.
Yes. Yeah. So it's like the basic premise of the joke. I'm not a comic genius like Pauly Shore, so I'm not going to do justice to it. But the basic premise is like he's complaining about his stepdad.
Wait, what'd you call me?
Son.
Yeah. Okay, Mark.
Mark?
Yeah, that's your name. You're not my real dad.
He'll get used to it. It's all right. Nice to see you this morning.
You're not my real dad. Mom, this guy always... You know, all he does is sit around the house.
What'd you get over here?
This is good.
I was thinking we have there's a great 2-week vacation in Bermuda. I was looking at.
Dude, mom, listen. You see how he's trying to weasel? He's trying to weasel trips to Bermuda, man. All he is a sponge. You know, you're just like a bigger version of me.
Yeah, that joke shows up so many fucking times, and it definitely shows up in whatever this episode of Totally Pauly is. So, yeah, I mean, I feel like it starts out, it's kind of scrappy. It's like a lot of it is just like Pauly, maybe a couple of extras. Maybe there's some kind of a basic premise. Like there's one where he's a hotel attendant. A lot of it is like Pauly has a job, you know?
Oh, is that the one that I was talking about where he gets distracted by the burger or whatever? I love that episode because that's so such. It's honestly upsettingly relatable to me. Because he's like starting to make the bed and then he gets distracted by a burger and then he gets distracted by something else and he goes back to the burger.
Oh, sorry about that. I was in here a little earlier and I was grinding some major chow, buddy. I was just really hungry. Anyway, let me just take a bite. White box is a kill burger, man. It's really hot. I'll clean it up. But this is just sweet, man. It's cool, right? Like, who's in here, man? This is the room, dude, where you weave nuts, but the Hollywood stuff kill chicks. Hi! Come on, buddy, it's fresh. See, here, let me make your bed for you. See, you want to have it all riled up so people think you're just psycho, like the weasel. Cool. Hey, also, you got to know that Wednesday, dude, is what if day, which is going to be buff. Oh, sorry. It's gonna be buff because we're gonna be playing some rap all day. Ziggy, 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 Zig, 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 Zig. Rap, buddy, it's gonna be stony, bro. Cool.
So yeah, and then totally different Pauly. I think you're right. It's a little more like Pauly in the real world. There's more of like a documentary. I mean, it's still obviously very curated, you know.
Yeah,
it's not a fucking Maisel's Brothers movie or something,
but it's, I mean, more like he does interviews with people on the street, which is very YouTube, and he does like he actually goes out and tries like actual things, actual scuba classes, and obviously it's like, you know, he has to ask to record and all that, so it's not like totally organic, but it's still like him interacting with people.
Right,
for better or for worse.
And there's a lot of, also, like you mentioned, there's a lot of cross promotion with his movies, which I think is very interesting since we're talking about the movies. And it's easy to forget that, like, when Encino Man was made, Pauly Shore was the biggest star of those three, three actors. I mean, that was Brendan Fraser's first ever. I think he might have technically shot School Ties first, but Encino Man came out first. So Brendan Fraser was at a, you know, this is, we're like almost 10 years before The Mummy, you know? And Sean Astin, he was like a, you know, he was a child star, but he wasn't, you're not getting butts in seats because of Sean Astin.
Yeah.
No offense to Sean Astin. But, you know, it's like, it was, Pauly was really like the attraction, and to the point that they took, again, they took his stand-up character and inserted him. The first time we see him in Encino Man, he is singing his actual song that was released as a single and had a video on MTV, Lisa Lisa.
Okay, so we did, or you did, because I didn't do any research, but you did discover that Lisa Lisa came first.
Yeah, Lisa That's Lisa hilarious. Preceded Encino Man. So he's like, he's promoting his own song in the movie. And it's, and like watching the totally different Pauly episodes really underlines that. Because he's honestly, I kept thinking about what a pain in the ass it must have been for everybody else involved with a movie that, like, they're trying to make a movie, and now here Pauly has his own crew.
Excuse me, you guys. I just want to get you guys all on camera on my show. Just say hi real quick so I don't get people coming up to me and saying you didn't put me on your camera, because it's hard to get everyone. So, get this is the whole crew.
Hi.
Say hello.
And they're filming like an annoying MTV show in the middle of the filming of the movie.
Yeah, but like, then you have to remember that it was Encino Man, which frankly,
well, yeah.
I don't think anyone would care about if Pauly Shore was in it, would they? Even Brendan Fraser doesn't really carry it.
Yeah,
like obviously he's good in that role, but like, I'm sorry, I'm not watching an hour and a half or whatever. Sam Gamgee is such a fucking bitch in that movie.
Oh my god.
Yeah. We'll just get, for a later episode.
Oh, I wanted to this didn't make it to my notes, but a real interesting like time capsule review I found again on Wikipedia, the source of 90% of my research. This is from Ken Tucker in Entertainment Weekly. This was published August 2nd, 1991. He said, if you're over the age of 20 and want a good scare in the early hours of the morning, be sure to check out Totally Pauly. What you'll witness is the sight and sound of young America 1991. The spectacle of a ragged-haired, slit-eyed beach bum announcing you're chilling major with the weasel.
Slit-eyed? I guess he's really stoned. Great, and so,
but maybe that's, yeah. I think the idea might be that he's so high that his eyes are slits. But yeah, an odd choice of words. Chances are you won't know what the heck is going on. Instant generation gap. Tons of teens are tuning in to Pauly Shore, who in the guise of a roving VJ interrupts MTV's ceaseless flow of Skid Row and Van Halen videos. Again, the little the time capsule-ness of Totally Pauly, to stroll through malls and converse in a modified San Fernando Valley speak. In Shore's laconic lexicon, anything buff is good. Money is fundage and attractive women are fresh nugs. One gets the feeling he decided to refer to himself as the weasel before others started calling him the pig. So it goes on from there. They also get in a little bit of a jab against, this is right after his album, The Future of America, came out. In Shore's comedy, punchlines are irrelevant. What counts is his cool dude attitude and his in-crowd lingo. His blithe refusal to offer punchlines is at once his stylistic triumph and his one-way ticket to Palookaville. He says, the future of America is a veritable oral dictionary of dude speak. It is also one unamusing little disc. Oh, Ken Tucker, not a fan of Pauly Shore. And, you know, not a lot of the criticism is accurate. You know, I'm not going to say that, like, no, you don't get it. But also, kind of you don't get it, right? Like, you know.
Well, no, I mean, it's an accurate assessment, but all of those things are what's good about it, in my opinion.
So, right. Yeah.
In goodness, I mean, I say good with, is it good?
Yeah, I mean, right. You know,
is that entertaining?
A generous interpretation of the word good. you know, last time I talked about the article from the Boston Globe, and Pauly really was like a fulcrum on which the generation gap in 91 turned. You know, we're talking about the future of America. Before we talk about that, I don't have much to say about it because I mostly agree with Ken Tucker's analysis. Oh, I will say one other thing. So in addition to Totally Pauly and Totally Different Pauly, there was also a third branding that I think was the Spring Break content. Because after he did the one, it's like then he gets his own segments at Spring Break. And that was called Chillin' with the Weez? Chillin' with the Weez. So I've only watched one episode of that, but it is a good one. It's the 93 Spring Break episode. Highly recommend that one. This is another one of Pauly playing like a straight adult character. He plays this newscaster called Pauly Shore, which is Pauly Shore with a suit and glasses, and he's doing like a square white guy voice.
Pauly Shore here for a special spring break update. As you know, spring break is breeding ground for decadent behavior for American youth.
And then he cuts over to a female newscaster named Paulette Shore, who is Pauly in a blonde wig.
Okay, I'm going to definitely have to watch this.
The whole thing is, you know, again, it's like we're using the expanded definition of good for this. But but there's an interview with Vince Neil where they talk about his solo single, You're Invited, But Your Friend Can't Come, from, of course, the Encino Man soundtrack. And also Vince Neil's line of swimwear. And then there's an interview, and then
I did not know that he had a, oh my God, I have to watch this. I'm a little upset that I didn't do more research, because for a while I was watching a ton of these episodes and I'm like, I can't watch anymore. And now I feel like you've actually watched more, or watched them more efficiently.
You never know. Yeah, there's always more buried treasures. That's why Totally Pauly Fan is still, you know, coming out with this stuff. And then a heckler comes out, like it's not real. It's a stage heckler, and he does like a bad comedy set. And then John Lovitz comes out to promote the movie. Do you remember the movie? You probably don't, because you were like one, but there was a movie around 92 called North. It was like a notorious box office bomb with I think Elijah Wood was in it. It's about Elijah Wood becomes like an emancipated youth, basically. It was a disaster. Like, it kind of ruined Rob Reiner's directing career for a while. But so that's what John Lovitz is promoting. And just like the incongruity of John Lovitz in Daytona Beach promoting North, being interviewed by Pauly Shore in, like, you know, full weasel pomp. And they also decide to do it, like, the conceit of the interview is that they hate each other. And so John, they keep like taking.
Can I just say, is the conceit of every Pauly Shore cameo, like, every, is, because that was the Charlie Sheen thing too.
Yeah.
There's a Totally Pauly episode where I was actually watching this right before we recorded. Charlie Sheen is on Totally Pauly, or Totally Different Pauly, whatever. And Pauly Shore is all excited to have him on there, and then Charlie Sheen is just kind of annoyed. He doesn't really want to do the show or whatever. And then it'll like show, he's supposed to be like off camera away from Charlie Sheen. He'll be talking about how he hates him.
Anything
I thought
for you.
This was like an important deal. You send me over to some rat hole in West Hollywood to hang out with David Koresh and drag, and I'm like, you know, I got things to do, man. I got a busy day, and
what are you talking about? What's...
You said this was an important press deal that I had. You know, this guy's got millions of viewers.
Right. It's the Weasel. You know, hey, you've heard of him, haven't you? You've seen him on MTV, haven't you? Curly hair, mop top, bo chilling on, you know.
You know I don't watch MTV, Sharon.
So, like, that's the Pauly Shore, like, formula. It's just, like, have a guest star, and they hate each other.
Yeah, there's a part where Lovitz is like,
my melons are totally tweaked. Yeah, that's
Your ticket thing is so beat, man.
Yeah, I'm a liar.
Yeah. You know, you're not funny. Wayne and Garth are funny, but not you.
So, again, it's not good. It's actually, it's kind of a challenging watch. Kia was in the room when I was watching it, and she was like, this is rough, Zach. I don't know how much more of this I can take.
I feel like you've just described, like, the sweet spot of what I like to watch, because,
yeah,
like, rough, awkward.
Yeah.
When the Wrestling Federation did that album, when they did that award show, it's some of my favorite watches. It's kind of like sound like the same mixture of like surreal and hard to watch
and cringe.
But like a very specific kind of cringe.
I definitely recommend the 1993 Spring Break Daytona Beach episode of Chilling with the Weeze. Also I've also seen the Charlie Sheen episodes of Total, and I struggle to think of two less compatible energies than Pauly Shore and Charlie Sheen. Like it is a pairing made in hell, but also heaven a little bit.
And it's hard to, cause like I'm obviously they were putting some of that on for the camera, but it's also like, even if that added layer didn't exist, it would still be awkward. Like even if they loved each other, it would be weird.
Even if they were good friends, it's like, what do these two guys, what do they talk about? What do they have in common?
I just quickly want to so the scuba diving episode that I saw, speaking of like the cringe, was on Totally Different Pauly. There's an episode where he takes scuba diving classes, and the clip from it that I watched right before we recorded was he was practicing scuba diving in the pool, and he put a candy bar at the bottom of the pool, and everyone thought it was a poop. Hilarity ensued. And then he like kept picking up and being like, guys, what's wrong? It's just a candy bar. It's just a candy bar. And it went on for a very long time. But at the beginning of that episode, he's doing like the street interview thing.
Hi, wait, stop for a sec. Everything's okay.
What?
How you doing?
Okay, fine.
What's your name?
Sunny.
Sunny Bono. Now, my name is Pauly, and we're here. Welcome to the show.
What show?
The MTV Totally Different Pauly Show. See that? It's wild, huh? you know what we're doing this whole week?
No, I don't.
We're going to go scuba diving. Want to come scuba diving with me and get certified? You probably snorkeled before they put the thing.
I got cerebral palsy. I'd like to.
Oh, okay. Well, next time then.
Sure. Okay. You know something? What? I'll learn.
You'll learn how to scuba dive.
Sure, I will. I just said that I was born paralyzed from the neck down. They said
you're walking fine. You seem to be okay.
But I'm not. But thank you very much.
Well, you seem like a very nice lady.
Thank you very much.
Well, take care of yourself.
Thank
Enjoy
you.
The day.
Okay,
see, it's okay. Everything will be fine.
Oh, sure.
Okay.
I hope you find your scuba.
All right. Take care, dear.
Okay.
Bye. Thank you.
I put it on while I was repotting my plant, so I just had it on the background, and it kept skipping between the scuba diving episode and the Charlie Sheen episode. So I would hear like Charlie Sheen and Pauly talking, and then I would hear like woo in the background, and then I just heard this awkward ass ending here when this round is like, I can't go scuba diving because I have cerebral palsy. Oh, it's so stupid. What a stupid show.
Yeah. So if all of this sounds appealing, so there's two more that I want to shout out.
I'm like, they could have edited that out, surely. Why was there no editing on the show? Instead, they just have this poor person on here.
That was the best stuff they got. They didn't have any other usable footage.
Yeah, there's no editing in Totally Different Pauly.
There's an episode of Totally Different Pauly that made me laugh a lot. And this is like, this is an example of, you know, what we were talking about last time about why we think Pauly Shore is funny. It's like, you can't explain it. You either get it or you don't. But there's this episode where he's in Texas. There's a whole series of episodes where he's in Texas. And at one point he's like backstage and he's talking about something. He's, you know, he's just like rambling to the camera, and literally mid-sentence, he cuts off. And you see him like look at something off camera, and then he like makes a beeline across the room. And it's because the camera pans over and you see there's a like security guy backstage with a long ZZ Top beard. And Pauly goes up to his beard and does this, he does like a gesture to outline the bottom of the beard. It's so funny. And it's just like the fact that he cuts off mid-sentence to go do that. And the guy doesn't seem very amused.
It's literally, I cannot stress this enough. It's like what I said in the last episode. It's like hanging out with your funny friend who has severe ADHD. Like, it reminds me of hanging out with, that's literally what hanging out with my best friend Andy was like in high school. It's what hanging out with my, when I worked at the comic shop, my friend Kino was like, it's like you, and it literally reminds me of that feeling. And I think that's why I appreciate it, because I'm like, I'm used to this kind of energy.
Right. Right.
And this specific kind of humor.
And then last but not least, of course, we got to talk about the Paisley Park episode. We're both huge Prince fans.
This was actually the first clip of Totally Pauly I ever saw, because I think Kenisa might have shared it for us.
Yeah. And this was such an interesting, this was a super interesting moment for me, because it was one of those, every once in a while, you know, because I do the blog and everything, and because our friend Kenisa is like a, she probably would not want me to describe her this way, but she's kind of like a Prince influencer, a Prince-fluencer, if you will. You know, she's like, she has a very popular social media account, and she's like connected to people. And so I'm just like plugged into the Prince fandom in a way that I'm not normally plugged into fandoms. And every once in a while, there is a moment where it seems like all of the Prince community goes one way and I go the other. And when this Totally Pauly episode came to like be noticed by the Prince fandom, this was one of those moments. Cause I was just like, oh my God, this polarizing moment. Yeah. I was like, this rules. Like, how cool is this? And everybody else was like, he didn't deserve to be in Paisley Park. You know, like if you go to the comments on one of the YouTube videos, is like 90% angry Prince fans, because they
clearly
feel like
he was supposed to be there. It's not like,
yeah, it's
like
not, he would have been thrown out if he was there against his will. So
it's also like what we were kind of talking about, like, do you know, I mean, obviously none of us know Prince, but like, right, are you familiar with Prince's sense of humor? I feel like,
which,
like what you said,
highbrow.
He would have,
yeah, right. He had a very silly, absurd sense of humor. And so I always kind of felt like, I bet Prince liked this. And you know what? I got Kenisa, she brings receipts. She sent this to us, the original Prince influencer, Dr. Funkenberry. I don't know the context exactly, but a picture of the receptionist at Paisley Park came up, and Funkenberry was like, she shared with me that for most of this, Prince was behind the cameraman watching Pauly be the weasel. And,
yes,
you know,
he was presiding over him and yeah, surely enjoying it.
Probably liked it. I'm not saying that he belly laughed, but it got a smirk. I think it got a smirk. I think Pauly got a smirk from Prince. And you all are just jealous that you didn't get a smirk from Prince.
Yeah. You're jealous that you couldn't be the weasel in Paisley Park.
Right.
I mean, this is the man, Prince is the man who, Erica talked about this in our podcast, but he released that like extremely emotionally gripping song, and the cover photo for it was that stupid meme of like the stick person like crying.
Right.
Like a,
right.
It's in the same vein of humor.
Or like there's skits on the MPG records that are literally like Prince and the members of the MPG doing like a fucking Jerky Boys prank call, you know, like if you think he's above the weasel, like, I don't know what to tell you. I don't know. This is just, I just felt the need to talk about this, because I feel like every 6 months or so, I just need to implore the Prince community to please lighten up. And this is one of those, moments.
He doesn't even, it's not like he's even being disrespectful in there. He's just being silly. Like he doesn't even meet Prince. Like,
right.
There's nothing in there that is like disrespectful to Paisley Park.
I mean, he like keeps singing Purple Rain, you know, but I mean, that's all like, what did you expect? The weasel to like know about bootlegs or something? Like, what the fuck do you want from this man, you know?
Right.
We're in Prince's heartland, buddy. Purple Rain, you know, you know, all that stuff, bro. Okay, cool. Check out a video and I'm gonna go see Prince. I think he's upstairs, buddy. If he's not, you know, I'll just go, where is he? Okay, cool. Check out a video. Don't say anything now that I'm cruising around.
Oh! Another good episode of Totally Pauly, and this will be the last one I mentioned. There's one where he's at, I think, Sam Kinison's house, and Sam Kinison was like bullying him. Because that's the Weasel's whole persona, he is a victim of bullying.
Right.
And basically, it's like he goes to his house, and Sam is there. So he, like, there are these two women who hang out at Sam Kinison's house, I guess. And so he's hanging out with them and eating pizza with them. And then Sam comes home and notices him there and is basically, like, giving him swirlies and, like...
Hey, man, what's going on, man? What are you doing with my women, brother?
Oh, I think
she's
all right.
It's totally Pauly, dude.
Well, dude, this is totally Larry.
Oh, God.
That's right, man. Do your job, Larry. No, it's the guys in my house. Okay. Now I'm at home, man.
Okay, dude.
You heard about calling first, dude? Huh? Did you ever calling?
We're going on tour, man.
Yeah, we sure are. The tour to hell. Oh,
Check out Jane Wheeling on MTV. Okay, dude, that's cool, Larry. Just let the Weasel Melon chill, bro.
So that's good Pauly watching, because I feel like it's funny because obviously Pauly started stand-up opening for Sam Kinison.
Right, right.
And so they obviously had, like, that's one situation where on the opposite spectrum of the Charlie Sheen thing, it's like still the same energy where they hate each other for some reason.
Right.
But also, like, you can, there's like chemistry there. You can clearly see that they like each other. But they still chose to have Sam bully Pauly.
Yeah.
that doesn't need to be the relationship they have, but it's the chosen, like, context for their interview.
Yeah. I'm glad you mentioned this because I think it's one of the core things about what makes Pauly Shore work for me. Because, you know, one of the things about him, like, he's very cute, you know, by comedian standards. And in most instances, the fastest way to get me to turn on you as a comedian is if you're conventionally attractive, you know? And I think Pauly knew that. I mean, he's, you know, he's clearly very aware that he's cute. That's what a lot of his comedy is. But he builds in this, like, underdog-ness to it, so it never feels obnoxious. It never feels, you know, like who's that guy right now that got famous on TikTok that everybody hates? You know who I'm talking about? Like, there's this TikTok comedian. I don't know. There's this cute guy.
No, but I usually hate social media comedians, so it could be a
comedian. Yeah. And so there you go. Like that, or, you know, like fucking Dane Cook. You know, like those guys suck. Like, so I feel
like Dane Cook specifically sucks for different reasons. I can't speak on anybody else, but
yeah. But I think Pauly Shore was smart about it, and he was like, okay, you know, if I'm gonna be doing this comedy thing, you know, obviously part of it is always to meet women, right? And so he wants to be, you know, attractive, but they build in this self-deprecating element that makes it not feel smarmy and obnoxious. To me, I mean, I know there's lots of people who would still argue that Pauly Shore is absolutely smarmy and obnoxious, but I think...
Well, it's built into his character that he's smarmy and obnoxious too. Like, in the Great Expectations dating one, I keep mentioning that because it's one of the clips that keeps coming up whenever I just put totally Pauly on and zone out. But, like, he, one of the girls, like, is naming things about him, and she's like...
I know you're from Hollywood.
Yeah.
Mom owns a comedy store.
Yeah. Okay. So I grew up around comedy.
There you go.
So I'm very funny and outgoing.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
A little obnoxious, too.
Sorry.
Which is funny because I get that, but it might just be that we don't find him obnoxious.
I guess, yeah. Even maybe. Though,
in the background, I can literally just hear him howling.
We're like, this is normal.
Yeah, it's totally fine.
All right, so we actually ended up going longer on Totally Pauly than I thought we would. I wanted to say a few quick things about his stand-up stuff. So I listened to his stand-up album, The Future of America. That came out in 91. It's very much modeled on his Totally Pauly fame. It's not very good. I will say that. I didn't crack too many smiles. I feel like a lot is lost in translation. You know, we've talked so much of what we talked about what works for us with Pauly is the visual element. And like I said last time, and like his mom said when he auditioned, his dancing is funnier than his stand-up. So when you don't get that, when you just get the jokes, I mean, I think Ken Tucker was kind of right. Like, there's not much they're there. I think what was interesting about it, so for one thing, it's very psychologically revealing. His mom is literally the first the first voice you hear on the album is his mother, who reminds him to use condoms while he's on tour. And like, as it, at the moment where, you know, you can kind of hear him like coming out on stage, you hear her voice echoing, "Don't forget about AIDS." So that's a thing. another thing I will say about it is it's probably the most enthusiastic and like on his side crowd that I've ever heard on a comedy album. I mean, obviously, if you're recording a comedy album.
You think
album,
that's like a Kiss Alive type thing where put in canned applause?
Like, obviously, if you're recording a stand-up album, you want the crowd to be sympathetic, you know, like you're not gonna record a stand-up album in front of a hostile crowd.
Bombing.
That would be fucking awesome.
That might like actually be funny.
KO, but for comic. That would honestly be more true to the Weasel, like if he was being booed the whole time. That
right.
Would be more accurate to the character. But you know, that joke I told or I talked about earlier about stepdads. He gets this huge laugh and like applause before he even gets to the punchline. Like,
because they probably had already heard it, and it looks like
they were like, "Oh yeah, this is gonna be good." Yeah, it's like he just gets to the part where he's like, "You're not even my dad," and people are like applauding, like, "Yeah, fuck you, Pauly's imaginary stepdad." It's just a weird. It's a weird energy. They're just like so into it. And, you know, this is the source of a lot of, or not the source, but it's, you can hear, this is a place where you can hear a lot of the stand-up stuff where a lot of his catchphrase come, like, you know, look at the woods you created. The Lisa, the album actually ends with Lisa, the song, but he also does the routine about Lisa and how like kind of the sleaziest girls are always named Lisa. It's very dated. Material. The parts that actually made me laugh were mostly like more surreal parts. Like there was this one, he was talking about condoms again, and he was like just riffing on recurring like, motif. You buy condoms at the grocery store, and then he kind of followed that train of thought to it's next to the Paul Newman spaghetti sauce. And then it was like, now the condom is a Paul Newman condom. And then he does like a callback to it later where he's like, he has sex with a woman and the condom gets lost inside her vagina. And then she pulls it out and throws it out the window. And then like somebody driving behind her, the condom hits their windshield and they like see Paul Newman's face. It's like the thing that makes it funny is the stupidest part about it, which is that this, like a condom would have Paul Newman's face on it. You know, like everything else about it was just kind of dumb and crass, you know? But I did enjoy the Paul Newman condom bit. So yeah, and then there's a follow-up album to that called Scraps from the Future, that's what it is. And that's very much like scraping the bottom of the barrel. The kind of the conceit is, it's like stuff that was a little racier than Paul Newman condoms. I mean, come on. It's he definitely didn't leave any A material on the cutting room floor. So if you're going to listen to one of these, I would say make it Future of America. Do we have anything to say about Lisa? I will just say it's Wipeout. It's basically just Wipeout, but with lyrics about being a stony, crusty dude with a mop on top.
Which, depending on your opinion, may be an improvement. I mean, it's worth a watch. It's kind of like a good, efficient shot of Pauly Shore. Like, if you watch that, you don't really need to watch Encino Man. You don't need to watch hours and hours of Totally Pauly, like we said.
Right. It boils it down to, yeah.
Like, especially not so much the actual song, but like the beginning part where he's auditioning Lisa's for the video. Right.
You're the last three fresh nugs. I'm going to ask you one question to see who can be in the video, okay? What do you want from life?
Well, I want to feed the children, house the homeless, save the rainforest, and finish up my woods class.
I want what she wants.
Okay, number three.
I want Bon Jovi cocktails and one night stands.
Bullseye. She nailed it, buddy. Ow!
So yeah, if you want to get an idea of Pauly Shore's humor
just
and
like
comedy,
a hyper-concentrated 3-minute dose just to see if it's like a microdose. I said microdose, but honestly, it's pretty, it's like, I actually prefer
it's like a macrodose. It's a lot.
Yeah,
it's
I prefer it spread out over many episodes of, I don't know if Lisa was my point of entry, I don't know if we would be here today, you know?
Like I feel like your point of entry should be Encino Man.
Right.
Then if you want to see
when
more,
you're 8 years
you
old.
can work your way up to Lisa, which is like weirdly, it has like a Nickelodeon, like for kids entertainment thing about it, but it's definitely not for children.
It's like very adult.
But that's also like it almost kind of like reminds me of the Mighty Boosh a little bit too, which is like basically Mighty Boosh brand. So that's also why I probably find it entertaining.
I will also just say a quick thing. So there's an extended something that Totally Pauly fan you can find on their channel. It's called Pauly's Totally Buff Special from 91, and it's basically a making of / extended skit part of the Lisa video. It was basically made to promote Lisa.
Was that the one I sent you that has all the extra stuff in it, like the him getting beaten up and throwing the trash? Okay, yeah, that's the one I sent you.
Yeah,
because I watched it separately. I watched the Lisa video twice, and the reason for that was because I watched it and then I watched the special.
Right. And in the comments, there's two things. It's like, one, if you're, for whatever reason, wanted to see a longer version of the Lisa video, here you go. But then also in the comments, this is very interesting. I cannot verify this, but I'm just going to believe that this is true. In the comments, this guy named Jeff Hendricks says, I've been searching this for over a freaking decade. Thank you for posting this. A crazy thing about this is the band playing Lisa is a band called the Dum Dums. On drum is Patrick Wilson, who would go on to form Weezer with Rivers Cuomo a couple of years later. And on bass is Pat Finn, the person who introduced Patrick Wilson to Rivers Cuomo. So there's a weird Weezer connection here.
If true.
I'm not a Weezer fan, so, you know, I can't verify, but that is very strange, if true.
Oh, and then it's kind of a connection, too, because we have the Weeze and the Juice. And then we have Weezer.
The Weasel meets Weezer. Yeah. That's maybe that's where they got the name from the band. I have one more thing to talk about, which is the HBO special Pauly Does Dallas. As of this recording, it is on YouTube for free. That is how I would recommend you experience it. I do not recommend paying money for it. I will, however, say of the Pauly Shore stand-up, the three Pauly Shore stand-up products that we're talking about, this is the right one to pick for a couple reasons. One is that, like I said, I think the visual element does a lot of heavy lifting with Pauly. So like, why would you want to just listen to him tell the jokes when you can also see him do this a lot? I don't know. It adds something to it. There are a lot of recycled jokes from Future of America. My suspicion is it's because they came out so close to each other that he didn't have time to write new material. Because usually when you... different specials have totally different jokes. And this has a lot of, like, you'll hear that old stepdad joke again. Get ready for that.
I'm glad, though, like, my mom never remarried, though. I don't have any stepdads hanging around the house. You know, guys that think they're my real dad, right? Let's go to the park, son! Yeah, okay, Mark. Well, why don't you call me dad? Because you're not, man. You're somebody that sits around my mom's pool and sponges off her. You know, kind of like a bigger version of me.
But then the other part of it that I like is that it has some definite, like, Totally Pauly DNA. So there are these man on the street type segments where he interacts. He's in Texas, hence Pauly Does Dallas. He interacts with locals. My favorite scene is he visits a fan, like a teenage fan of his, and comes to her house because she wrote him a letter. And I mean, I'm sure a lot of this was like you know, it's less organic than it appears. Obviously, I'm not an idiot, but you know, the idea is that she writes him a letter and then he shows up at her house. And at some point he's like, hey, can I take a bubble bath? and he takes a bubble bath in her house. And then he gets up from the bubble bath and runs out of the house completely nude. So last time I said there's at least two times that I've seen Pauly Shore's ass. Number one was Phantom of the Mall, Eric's Revenge. And number two is Pauly Does Dallas. So if you're on the lookout for, you know, Pauly Shore's bare ass, then this is one way for you to experience that.
What do I think of Pauly Shore? Not everybody will come in my house and bathe in dog shampoo and then run naked out through my yard.
It's just cute to see him interact with his fans. And also, this was weirdly one of the more relatable things about Pauly Shore. Because, like, when I was in high school, I remember I visited a friend's house, and they had, like, a lot of money. And so they had a TV in their bathroom. And I was like, oh, my God, I want to take a bath and watch TV at the same time. Can I do that while I'm at your house? And they let me do it. I didn't run out of the house completely nude, but it was one of the more Pauly Shore moments in my life. So when I saw him do that, I was like, oh my God, we're the same.
He's just like me for real. But also recently, Kia found that Reddit thread where a fan was saying in his hotel room that he took a bath. So apparently this is like a recurring, there's like a lot of recurring motifs here.
Like, yeah. It makes it a little weirder that this is like apparently just a thing he did with like,
yeah.
Cause this woman, she said she was like 18 at the time. And it's a little, you know, like I knew coming into this, that it's basically a ticking, we're racing against the clock between us finishing this series and Pauly Shore getting canceled. So, like none of these stories are shocking to me. I just hope that we can get through the rest of them before we hear something really bad. But yeah, if you,
do you think Pauly Shore is a candidate for cancellation? Like, do you think anyone's really checking for Pauly Shore enough?
I don't think so. Yeah,
like, don't listen to Pauly Shore's Pauly Does Dallas anymore. Right.
And I will Encino
Man.
I will say, like, the context of this. So the context of this Reddit post was who's the grossest person you would have sex with? And somebody said Pauly Shore. But then this person was like, I did have sex with Pauly Shore and it was gross. But, you know, it's like it wasn't like this was a traumatic story. You know, it was like, well, this was weird. You know, it's like one of those things where it's like, wow, I can't believe that I went to Pauly Shore's hotel room and he took a bubble bath. Honestly, the whole scenario kind of gives me Prince vibes.
Yeah, the bubble bath.
So maybe.
Prince also did love to take baths.
Yeah, once again, the Prince fans a little too hasty to judge. Maybe Pauly and Prince have more in common than you thought.
Than you care to admit.
All right, so we gotta wrap it up because we got to talk about Encino Man. As always, we'd love to hear from you about any of this stuff. Encino Man, Class Act, Totally Pauly Shore in general, weird Pauly Shore sex stories, like all of it.
Yeah, and have you had sex with Pauly Shore? Please send in your stories. We would love to hear them.
Yeah,
has Pauly Shore taken a bath in your house?
If you're willing to be a guest and share, like, you know, hit us up. We're on Instagram at DystopianGram. We're on YouTube at Dystopian Dance Party. We're on the web at dystopiandanceparty.com. And once again, you can email us. I'm awfully lonely. Nobody's emailed us yet at heybuddy@dystopiandanceparty.com.
Do you want to clarify how many U's are in chat? Maybe that's the problem.
I put it up on the video, but it's three U's. It's hey buddy.
Maybe they're all getting bounced back because people are putting two or four U's in there.
There's just like a slew of emails. Everybody's like, why is it going through? Also, here's something we probably should have mentioned last time. You can subscribe to our podcast. We're on all of the, but it's actually, it's better timing now because I made a separate feed. So now if you just go to your podcast provider of choice, just say Year of the Weasel, but, you know, type it or say it in voice activation.
Yeah, you can say it in Siri. Siri, play Year of the Weasel. I hope I set up Alexa playing Dystopian. You're already listening, so it doesn't matter, but presumably you're already listening.
We're also on Spotify now. I finally dropped my one man beef against Spotify. You know, so that's where you get your podcast. There you go. Year of the Weasel is on there. We're going to have to start selling like supplements or something to be like more Joe Rogan-esque. So yeah. There's ways for you to keep in touch with us. Thanks for listening. We'll see you in a couple weeks.
Bye.